Good evening, everyone. Good evening. We are back with the Quarantine Concert Series. I am your host, Kabir Segal. We are here every single night, 10 p.m. Eastern. This is a very special show because it is show number 30. We have done 30 shows in, I think, 2.5 weeks. We are religious. Just like taxes, you can count on this show happening. Every single night, 10 p.m. Eastern, we're addicted to bringing you the music. All right, so why are we doing this? By now, you know we are suffering an international emergency. And people are losing their lives, and it's very, very dire outside. The musician community, the creative community, is also severely affected. All the gigs have been canceled. They've been abridged. They've been nixed. They've been abrogated. They've been removed. It's hard out there for musicians, for anyone touching live events, the engineers, the producers, the promoters, the bookers. There's a whole ecosystem of people who are kind of scrambling right now because all the gigs have gone away. So we've started this concert series. If you know someone who's an artist, reach out to them, give them some love, listen to their music, stream them on Spotify, buy their music, buy their t-shirts, pray for them, you know, just be there for them. This is the time. We got to come together. This show was started to put the spotlight back on the artists. That's where it belongs. They give us so much joy and love with their music. Least we can do is show them the love that we appreciate them. All right. Number two, where can you find us? You can find us everywhere. I'm here every night, 10 p.m. Eastern, from my parents' house in Atlanta. My parents are sleeping upstairs, and we're turning the dining room table into a party. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram Cracker. You can find us on LinkedIn for all you vice presidents, associate vice presidents, software engineers, marketing directors, chief financial officers, account directors, chief media operators, CEOs, chairmen. If you're watching on LinkedIn, this is the good stuff. This is the music. You belong here. Your heart belongs here. All right. So you can find us on LinkedIn. You can find us on YouTube and on, I guess, everywhere. So just subscribe. Subscribe so you can be the first to know. Excuse me. I'm getting choked up just thinking about how much work we're doing. All right, so how do you get on the show? You get on the show. It's tough. I'm sorry. We want to be there. We're trying to create as many gigs as possible. We have a waiting list of over 60 artists trying to get on the show. Please, please, you know, give us your patience because we're trying to get through as carefully and as thoughtfully as possible without offending too many people. We're trying to do it. Thank you for watching. Thank you for watching. We're averaging over 50,000 viewers per episode now. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We're really grateful. Thank you to our partners, LinkedIn and Facebook, for helping us support these broadcasts. We really appreciate it. All right, so that's the public service announcement. Now we get to the fun part of the show, the part you're all here for. Not for me, but for the encounter with genius. This man, I call him the Einstein of the piano. I know Einstein played the violin, but if Einstein did play the piano, this is what it would sound like. I've known this man for a few years. I'm a big fan of his. This series, I like to ask questions, but I'm just thinking about not asking him any questions, having him play all the way through, because he's that good. I don't want to interrupt him with my questions, but we will, because I know you have a lot of questions for him. So with that, please welcome to the show the Grandmaster himself, Hector Martignon. Hola.
Hola, Kabir, ¿cómo estás?
Muy bien, muy bien. Hablas español ahora.
Sí, español.
Sí. How was my introduction? Was that okay? Was that
amazing. You're hired. Officially.
Thanks. You can bring me to your gigs. I'll be happy to do that.
Anytime.
So tell me first, how has the pandemic affected you? Have you had to cancel many gigs?
Yeah, wow. Many tours in South America. A tour in Italy and in Germany, and one to Tahiti. not canceled, that's postponed. Some of them are postponed, some are just flat out canceled. But yeah, quite a few gigs and tours.
Tell me more about the Tahiti gig. That sounds like you might need a someone like me to come along and announce you.
Yes, I have a very good friend in Tahiti, Felix Filches, a great bass player, and he lives there, and he brings a lot of musicians to play in all the islands, but mainly in Papeete, Morea, Bora Bora, and every 2 years I go there, two or three years, and play with some local musicians, but also I bring like a rhythm section usually from here, from New York, or LA also, which is closer.
Mm-hmm. Do you bring your bathing trunks?
Of course.
Smart man. See, yeah. The Einstein of, so.
Or bathing.
Yeah, exactly. So have any of these gigs been rebooked, or is it still, are they canceled indefinitely?
No, I had two concert series in Colombia, where I'm from. In Bogota, in the University of Javeriana, and another festival. And that's been, for now, put on ice, you know, but it's going to happen probably next semester because it has to do with the university. The tours in Germany are probably canceled for good. I don't think they're going to rebook them. And what else? Yeah, that's it. Only the ones in Colombia are still going to happen probably. At Tahiti also.
Yeah,
most likely. Yeah.
Are you?
So you're on.
Where are you broadcasting from tonight?
From my living room.
In
Manhattan.
In Manhattan. Do you have a mask?
No.
Okay.
Well, not now. Not on. But
no,
I have
no, I
mask.
Know. Yeah. But you yeah, have one.
A, yeah, of course, of course.
Okay, good. Yeah. All right. Do you have lots of Purell? Lots of this stuff.
What is that? The disinfectant.
Yeah.
No, I use soap. Most of the time, yeah.
That also works. That also works. Cool, man. So it sounds like you're so I even see Ismael Castro is writing. You'll be rebooked. So a lot of faith.
Oh, good.
That Ismael he says you'll be rebooked.
All right, Ismael. How are you, man?
All right. What would you like to begin your performance with tonight?
You know, I'm going to start with a tune I wrote some years ago for two of my Brazilian idols. Hermeto Pascoal and Egberto Gismonti. And the tune
best.
I wrote is called Ode to Herr Monti. I invented this name. So it's a very exciting and difficult piece, but I'm going to try here on my piano. Should I go ahead?
Yes, sí.
Okay.
Vamos.
I take off my headphones.
Claro.
Thank you. Whatever you are.
They love you. Me encanta. So for that, they're very well trained.
They stop all together.
For your next album, we should have this. We should have them on the album, right? And you can conduct them. They're very good, very well trained. Beautiful, very beautiful.
Thank you.
Tell me about you have a. I like this look. It almost looks like you're on my. You know how they talk about having the angel on your shoulder. You're like the angel on my shoulder here. With this look. Tell me about your background. Is you're from Colombia. You studied in Germany.
Right.
Why did that happen? That's not that normal path.
My sister is a great mathematician. She's a professor in Germany still at this day, and she went to study in Tübingen, and she told me you should come. I was studying engineering. Electrical engineering in Colombia, but I always wanted to study music, but everybody told me, no, you have to do something that makes money, you know, you have, it was a wise idea to study engineering. I love it. It's a very good thing, very important, but I always wanted to play music. And then I went to my sister in Germany, and then I got into starting with great a Russian professor and then a German professor and piano teacher, and I just got into the classical music scene in Germany and finished and worked a lot, and I lived 10 years there in Germany. Then I went to Brazil for 1 year, and then I came to New York.
So you've truly a man of the world. How often do you get, I know you said you're about to tour in Colombia, how often do you get back to Colombia? Do you find that to be your original musical language, the music of Colombia?
Yeah, definitely. Before doing jazz, I did classical music because my parents love classical music and jazz, of course, but mostly classical music. And we always heard pianists coming home and playing. But the music from Colombia always stuck with me. Even to this day, I really love it. And not only from Colombia, mainly Colombia, but also from Venezuela, Brazil, Argentina. Latin America is the music that is in my heart. And then classical music from little infancy, I started hearing and playing a little bit, and then I started that. But slowly tried to get into the language of improvisation of jazz, which is closer to my idiosyncrasy, the way I am improvising and improvising with a schema, structure, exactly. Mm-hmm. Like in jazz, you have the structure, but then you improvise, you communicate with the other musicians. Yeah.
Got it.
So it's a mixture of all of them.
Got it. If you have a question for the maestro, please ask us. And Ismael Castro says you play a great accordion too. Is that true?
Not great, but thank you, Ismael. I play accordion. Yeah, I play. I have done recordings, but it's another world. It's something you have to dedicate a lot of time, and I don't have the time. But sometimes when I have to do a work, like a recording or something, I study, I practice, and then I come back and love it. I love it. The sound and everything. Yeah.
Another question for you, maestro. What do you keep in your piano bench?
Here in the stand or in the bench, I have a lot of Bach, a lot of Chopin. I practice every day. I'm doing the Art of the Fugue of Bach and Chopin, the four ballads, Etude. I do a lot of Ravel.
Very nice.
Yeah.
So you have the canon in there. Do you have a sharpened pencil in there?
Yeah, very sharp.
How about any food? Do you have any food in there?
No,
Okay,
I don't good. eat. Yeah, I eat music.
That's good. Music, food for the mind. Okay.
Food for the mind.
What would you like to play next?
I'm thinking to do a jazz standard I love. I just learned it not long ago for a class I'm doing at Hofstra University. We analyzed it, so I'm gonna play Tenderly.
Thank you.
I want to see you bow, man. I want to see you bow. Yeah. See?
Yes.
Who needs Tahiti when you have a crowd like this, right?
Yeah, right. Who needs Tahiti?
Yeah, you can also put your bathing suit on. It's fine. Yeah, we're all at home. We're all comfortable. So that was beautiful. Such a beautiful rendition. Let me show you some of the love that's coming into some. You have claps. There's some hearts coming in. Let's see here. Claudia Miranda wants to know, who are your biggest musical influences?
Personally, I had my mother, who was a great, actually a good pianist, amateur pianist, and also great music lover. And a friend of the house who came to practice a pianist from Italy called Giacomo Marcenaro. He's the one where I learned a lot of the piano, the classical repertoire from. And those are my most important influences that I knew, that I actually met. Then, of course, then in the piano realm, in the jazz piano realm, obviously Bill Evans, James B. Johnson from a completely different period, Herbie Hancock, I love Herbie Hancock, and then the writing of Gil Evans, because I like to arrange a lot and orchestrate. And in the classical music, Ravel is one of my favorites, Shostakovich. Every time it changes. Sometimes I hear a lot of older piano, like the Striders, like James B. Johnson, Fats Waller, and the old style piano of that period of the 30s. Then I like more the bebop player, Wynton Kelly, you know, those Red Garland. And then I go into the more modern ones, Brad Meldo. You know, every time it changes. But the main guys that I always listen to is Ravel, Bach, Bill Evans.
Yeah.
And Humberto Gismonti, also in the Brazilian realm. That's basically more or less it.
It's, yeah. I also want to ask you, before you play your next one, tell me about your last big band record, The Big Band Theory. Tell me about that album. Why did you want to put that out? And what was the process like? Did that take you a long time to do the arrangements and all that?
Well, the arrangements, we had a residency at a club downtown in it's called the New Rican Poets Cafe, a beautiful venue downtown in 3rd Street in the East Village. And at the beginning, I had a small band. And then I said, well, I always wanted to write for big band. And I said, this is the opportunity. You know, we play for the difference between $20 and $50 is not that big. So I said, let's just get enough people and they make $20, sometimes $30, $40. But a lot of great musicians came just for the fun of it and meeting and playing music. And every week I wrote at least one arrangement. That was my goal. And we basically rehearsed on stage on the gig and people loved it. You know, the audience came and they noticed, okay, we stopped, we start again, let's do this, let's do that. And they kind of enjoyed us practicing with it, you know, with them as audience. And a lot of great music came and I learned a lot about arranging in that moment, in those gigs. And we went for a year and something, a year and a half or 2 years. Then I said, I want to do a record. And then and then with Soho, they tell me, yeah, let's do it. Soho Records, you know them, Johan and all the Iris and all the people at Soho, you know, they were very encouraging. And I finished the project. I went 2 days, recorded the whole album in 2 days with strings. It was unbelievable, the musicianship of those friends. And also, it's I had an idea that having a standard format record with a big ensemble that is a standard, I could work with a lot of bands also in other places. Just, there's a lot of big bands in Europe, in South America, in North America, everywhere, in Japan. So I would have an opportunity to play music with those bands in other places. and of course here with my big band, but that's so much work that I just gave it up for a while, and right now I'm concentrating more in small ensembles.
Got it. Well, it's a beautiful record, and I know it's a great Zoho release. I do know them, Yochen and Iris, great people. I think what's so beautiful about that is there's such a range of material on there, the breath, and also the playing is sparkles. Talk a little bit about, you talked about doing small group bands. Who do you like to play with? When people see Hector play live, who do you normally play with?
I develop a very good musical and personal relationship with this amazing percussionist from Colombia, Samuel Torres.
Yes.
He's an incredible musician, not only percussionist, he's a composer and arranger of the first, highest rank. And we understand each other because we speak the same languages. We speak the classical, we approach the classical world the same way, the jazz, and the South American folklore, the rhythms of Colombia. And so we kind of understand each other. And I also appreciate the space that the percussion gives the piano. The piano is not as loud an instrument that you have to, it's not easy to compete with loud instruments. And so the percussion is more subtle, and the dynamic range is also huge. And I like that. And on bass, I have a good relationship with a Mexican bass player called Rudy Vidal. He came not long ago to New York. He's amazing, and he plays the music from Mexico and from Colombia, from everywhere, also jazz very well, and also Gabriel Vivas on bass. Those two are my bass players right now that I love playing with. And on vibraphone, sometimes if there's space, because the vibraphone is a huge instrument, just as the piano, Christos Rafalides, I play and record a lot with him. He's on the album, the Big Band album also, Christos, and on vibraphone. I love the sound of the vibraphone also with the accordion. That's one of the reasons I like vibraphone, because it's a good blend with accordion. It's so beautiful.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What would you like to play next, Maestro?
Well, I wrote some preludes for my students, actually 24 preludes in all the keys, and 24, and I'm going to play a couple of them. I'm going to start with one of the most difficult ones, is in C minor, the second prelude.
Okay.
And should I play the next one right away?
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah. That's it's one that I want Axel Logard to play. It's a good friend of mine. And I wrote some of these preludes with not only students, but also colleagues of mine that are very good pianists. And I want him to play the next one, which is very good for the left hand. Thank you.
Awesome. Awesome. Awesome.
Kabir? Thank you.
Touchdown, touchdown, goal.
All right. Yeah, Kabir.
All right. Hey, I think you have to request to join my Instagram again. I think you dropped.
Yeah, I know the battery run out.
Okay. Hey, if you're watching on Instagram, come on over to my Facebook page. The party's great. A few questions going on here for you. Donna has a question here. She says, did you publish those preludes?
Not yet. I'm planning to do that very soon, but I haven't had the time. But I want to publish them. Yes, definitely.
Okay.
She can give me her address or email or something, and I can definitely send her a link or something to download them or see.
Got it. Very cool. Thanks for offering that. What kind of piano are you playing? People are asking.
I have a very good Estonia. Obviously it's made in that country, in Estonia, and it's the mechanic of the piano is like a Steinway, like a Hamburg Steinway, and the rest is original in Estonia, and very good wood in that country, and I love it. I love this piano very much. I hope it sounds good out there.
Yeah, it sounds great. Sounds great. Do you have a special? Do you ask for that type of piano when you play gigs, or do you have a special piano that you always look for?
No, it's very hard to get the piano you want. So you have to deal with whatever they have. But mostly they have good pianos in venues. They usually have Steinways and Yamaha. There's very good Yamahas and. All kinds of pianos, but mostly they're good. I never have big problems with pianos, especially here in the States or in Europe. It's usually very, very good pianos, but I don't have an endorsement with a piano factory or so, no.
Yeah, I gotcha. Tell me about the album before, the Second Chance album. Walk me through that album. Why did you want to put that album out?
That album, it was the Second Chance. In a way, that song has a special meaning for me for many reasons. But the album before, Refugee, got the first nomination that I had for the Grammy. I call it Grammy Nation. And I said, well, let's have a second chance. And exactly that happened. It was also nominated. And the song, there's a song I dedicated to my wife. It's called Second Chance. And I can actually play it. I like that. I like to play that song.
Can you explain the significance of that title? What's the significance of Second Chance? What do you mean by that?
Well, in relationships, you have to go back sometimes and do things differently or better. And that's exactly what I had in mind. Do things again, but in a better way. That's what I meant when I wrote
that
tune.
Did you?
I hope so. I think so. But I have to say, at this moment, I'm like 11th chance.
Right. Right. Well, breaking news, right? Well, I hear you. Well, that's so, I guess, personal and profound when you could write about something that's close to you and special to you, that often makes the most,
yes,
makes the music even more substantial when you're writing about personal things like
but
that.
That's what happens with me, at least. There's two types of compositions that I write. Mostly is autobiographical, like in a geographic point of view, like a place I loved or I didn't or something. There's a lot of tunes I wrote about places. And then again, what you just mentioned, like relationships with people that are very important, and that is also one of the main themes of my composition. And then again, for the piano, I write a lot of stuff for my students or for colleagues that I think, oh, I could write this for this guy. would never play. You know, that's another motivation for me.
Yeah. Nelson Rivera said, te acuerdas.
Exactly. Very much. Nelson, ¿cómo estás?
Yeah.
Are you guys looking at Facebook right now? Yeah, because
You're famous on Facebook right now. We can see your smiling face. Muy guapo. And Donna wants to know, I think you talked about this a little bit, who are some of your favorite composers? You talked about it a little bit.
I mentioned classical composers. Bach is definitely the best composer of all for me. I could, like the famous question, the desert island, what would you take with you if you had only one choice? I would take Bach.
Well, you're stranded right now.
Exactly, so. But I have all the choices in music, but Bach is one of my choices. Yeah, definitely.
All right, cool. So you want to play Second Chance?
Okay, yeah, let's play Second Chance.
Thank you. So good. I didn't want it to end. I was waiting for Nelson to solo on that one.
Oh, yeah. Well, Nelson, where's your guitar?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I'm sure he has it somewhere. Just beautiful. I mean, I want you to go back after and look at all the great comments you're getting on Facebook. Oh, wow. And cool. all the love that you're getting from around the world. We have people from Japan and Thailand and India tuning in.
Wow.
So you're
places yeah. I want to go.
Exactly, exactly. We should get you there, the
yes,
Hector
yes.
Around the World oh, tour. Yeah.
Very good, very good.
Yeah.
Yes.
Why don't you play, we're running a little short on time. What would you like to play next?
A piece that has Colombian rhythm. It's called Pasillando.
Okay.
It's Pasillo and Joropo.
Standing ovation. Yeah. Hold on. I'm going to bring you a present. Here we go. Hold on one second.
I'm going to connect again.
I got some flowers here for you.
I don't see them, but I'm going to try to get back to you.
I want everyone to see at home.
Where are you, Kapil?
Hector.
Kapil, are you online?
Hector. Oh, yeah. Dude, that was awesome.
Thank you, man.
Electric.
I'm trying to get back on Instagram.
Yeah. Oh, no, I canceled it. So we're here in the now.
In the Facebook.
Brilliant. Okay. Just brilliant. Let me ask you, what's next for you? What are you working on next?
I'm very concentrated in a course I'm doing at Hofstra University on orchestration, and I'm learning a lot and teaching the same, and that's one thing that I'm concentrating right now, because that I can do online, and also my teaching private students I can do from home. And I'm practicing the four ballads of Chopin, which are extremely difficult pieces, and but it's a good concert repertoire. And also practicing the art of the fugue, you know, a lot of classical piano, not composing much. Somehow it's not inspiring, this situation right now. It's kind of, I don't know, bring me down, at least creatively. It's not really bringing good ideas.
Yeah.
A lot of friends are sick, family, you know, so you worry a lot. It's not easy to be creative when you're worried like that. And but I hope to go back if this is over soon. I want to go back on the road with a small ensemble. Definitely bring out a record that I have recorded that it came out very good with some of the music you heard tonight.
Yeah.
And I want to bring that out also very soon, with that, and go on tour with that quartet. I have
Wonderful.
Also a project with some Cuban musicians I work with on tour. I went on tour to China, to Europe, and we had a project together, a 14-piece band that we recorded each one song. And that's a project, it's on ice for a year and a half, and I want to bring in that also. So those are my two main projects for the medium.
Yeah, yeah.
Future, but you never know what's coming after this. If
totally.
After this, you know.
You have to get back to Tahiti, and also Ismael Castro says bring him back to Freiburg, Germany, where he worked his you know what off.
I met Ismael in Freiburg. I mean, I'm talking about many years ago, and I started playing salsa in Germany, in the army barracks of the United States. You know, the occupation army in Germany. I'm talking barracks all over Germany, and they brought salsa bands. That's how I started playing salsa and Latin, you know, Afro-Cuban music.
Yeah.
And I met Ismael, and we put a band together. Ismael,
nice.
Un abrazo fuerte.
Thank you so much for joining us, Hector. It's really a pleasure to experience your genius. It's always... last time we talked, I was saying before the broadcast, you were in China, and I hope we get an opportunity to, I get an opportunity to see you play live in person when this is all over, this quarantine is over.
Yes, but Kabir, thank you so much for this.
My pleasure.
This initiative that you're doing is fantastic for everybody, for the musicians, for the audience. It's so beautiful.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you, my friend. I just want to say a quick shout out to the sound and tech team.
Oh yeah.
Sandra and Camilo, they really earned it tonight. They were working and plugging in advising work, which cord connects to what. So check out their website. Their incredible mixing, mastering, audio team, soundworksrecording.com. They're a very nice, friendly people, good looking people, hygienic people. They also have two dogs named Oreo and Maui. So if you ask for the Oreo and Maui discount, you'll get two woofs off the price. Woof, woof. So please, please ask for that. And they're open for business. So all you people watching who need, you know, mixing and mastering service, any kind of audio services, hit them up. Please ask for the Wolf Wolf discount. All right, that is it for tonight. Tomorrow night, we're going to have some great classical violin. Ariana Kim is a virtuoso violinist. Join us 10 p.m. Eastern tomorrow night. Until then, stay safe. God bless. And good night.
Good night, Kabir.
Buenas noches.